Well, I'd like to welcome you to UNC Asheville. I think it's appropriate that the day that we're talking about the floods, that it's a rainy, gray day out there. So hopefully it puts us all in the mood. For those of you that haven't been in the this center, I hope you enjoy, some of the new look and feel of UNC Asheville as well, too. And now that you're here, we did announce the UNC Asheville basketball schedule yesterday. Please join us for some of the basketball games, that's starting out. We've actually got Western Carolina, UNC Charlotte visiting us this year, so ought to be a very exciting season. I'm Jim Fox. I'm the director of UNC Asheville's National Environmental Modeling and Analysis Center. And we had our formation of the group 10 years ago. And so not only are we commemorating 10 years of the flood, but this is the 10-year anniversary of the formation of NEMAC as well, too. And there's one person here that I'd like to especially recognize, and that's Dr. John Stevens, the founder of NEMAC and its original director. Well, I see a lot of familiar faces in the room. I see some new faces as well, too, so thank you for joining us. We've got a really great group of speakers. I do want to thank Greg Dobson on the NEMAC staff and Dr. Doug Miller with Atmospheric Science for helping pull all this together as well, too. I get to stand up and take credit for the hard work of people like that, on our staff that really are great at these things. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to have two sets of talks separated by a break. We're going to try to give about 20 minutes per talk, and we're really going to hold kind of the questions till the end of each session, just so that we can make sure we stay on schedule. We've got a lot of information, and I don't want to be taking away time from some of the speakers later on in the agenda as well, too. They've got some really good information to share with us. The real theme that I want you to be looking at is all of us working together. The point of collaboration, that it takes a whole group of us working together to be able to face the challenges that we look at when we start looking at a major stressor like flooding and how it relates to weather and climate in our community. And so just as you see the different speakers coming together, it's just a real pleasure for UNC Asheville to be working with our community and regional partners in this sort of effort. So welcome. And let's get started. As I mentioned, we really would like to thank a lot of our different partners. These are a lot of the partners of NEMAC. I would also like to recognize the new logo that you're seeing on this slide, and that's the McCullough Institute at UNC Asheville. If you're not familiar with the McCullough Institute, it launched earlier this year. There is a flyer on the back table, and Leslie, why don't you raise your hand? It's Leslie's family, through their generosity, that have established the McCullough Institute and really gives UNC Asheville another way to be working in collaboration with our community for actually implementing ways to be building resilience in our community. So I want to recognize the great generosity of the McCullough family, too. You can see the variety of different partners we have here, local and state government companies, others as well, too. So let's remember 2004. What happened? Well, there's the pictures that you saw playing on the screen as you walked in, the immediate knowledge of, oh, here is this rising water, especially as we saw it coming down the Swannanoa and into Biltmore Village, the pictures that really stick in our minds. But when you start looking at really bottom line impacts as well, too, that the top left picture is the broken water main. Our city was without drinking water for 3 days, McCray? And the impact on tourism. This did happen in September. The fall gets to be a very active time for our community as well, too. So when you look at the impacts on Western North Carolina, we really have to relate, all the different impacts. Unfortunately, 11 people died. Rick Wooten is actually going to be talking to us about the landslides. That's where people lost their lives. Most people don't think about these sorts of storms, you know, with rising water having the other major impact, but we actually got the loss of life through the related landslides. A lot of homes destroyed, many more damaged, a lot of businesses as well too. We lost almost $100 million in tourism revenue due to that interruption. Obviously, the people interested in the environmental side, you know, 100,000 gallons of petroleum were spilled into this French Broad River Basin, really looking at an over a $200 million impact. I do want to put this in the proper frame, though, that this was a major storm and a major flood event. But if you compare it to the 1916 flood event, people have estimated that if you look at the 1916 flood and you put it in today's dollars, that that storm would have caused $4 billion worth of damage. And so 2004 was a wake-up call. The reality is as though that we can be expecting another 1916 flood sometime as well too. So what occurred? I'm not going to go over this in detail. Doug Miller and other people much more knowledgeable about this, but we are looking at these tracking hurricanes that are dumping lots of rain. And the fact is that these are not that uncommon. You know, there have been damaging floods about average every 20 or 25 years in our watershed. And Jerry Vihan is going to be talking about some of those in 73 and 77 as well, too, in addition to 2004. Well, what's the story here? Well, if you look at average rainfall across our mountains, we can see by this map, and especially Buncombe County where we are at, we are really one of the driest points in the southeast. On average, we get less than 40 inches of rain a year. But if you look at the surrounding mountains, you know, here in Transylvania County, Mount Mitchell, that they get more than twice that amount of rain, sometimes up to three times that amount of rain. And so when you look at this focusing effect of a lot of rain falling on the mountains, falls on the mountains, but where does that go? It has to come into the valleys, come right into the rivers. Those rivers flow right through our communities. And the Swannanoa and French Broad meet where? Right in the middle of Asheville. And so these are these focusing effects that we start looking at then. This map is from the WNC Vitality Index. I hope each of you got an opportunity to pick up one of the water brochures in the back. You can see the linkages of this water into our system here for Western North Carolina. Well, the way that we communicate this information then is to try to take a lot of the science and put it into information that all of us can consume. And if you look at this map, you know, I could start saying, oh, well, you know, you can see high elevations in white, lower elevations in green, and I can talk about this concept of a watershed. Well, a lot of us really love maps, but the vast majority of our citizens really don't understand, you know, a map. And if I start saying, oh, the Swannanoa watershed, and outline the red area, that doesn't mean so much to them. And even if we zoom in and take that same watershed and that same color and say, oh yeah, there is this connection between this whole idea of Black Mountain, the Swannanoa, Asheville, the North Fork Reservoir, Mount Mitchell. It's still a little bit hard for most people to understand. But if you put that same picture into a 3D view, and people can now see the outline and understand the topography and see how the water fits together, you're starting to see ways to start taking scientific information and turn it into visuals. And this is a graphic that was created by Greg Dobson, our staff, and he's going to be giving a talk at the end of this about, you know, how to be using these tools to really be aiding understanding of what these issues are about. But if you take that same 3D view and you put the rainfall amounts from just Hurricane Francis on top of that, you can see what the issue is here. Up on top of the mountain, there was greater than 12 inches of rain, where here in downtown Asheville, we were only received about 4 inches of rain. That if you're trying to manage this situation and you're just kind of standing in downtown Asheville, yeah, it might be raining a little bit hard, but it's not raining that hard. But if you're looking at managing the North Fork Reservoir and, you know, the great difference between 12 inches of rain over that same period and 4 inches of rain is significant. And so the city and county put together a flood damage reduction task force to really be looking at this issue and to be saying, well, how can we actually mitigate this? And so the first thing we wanted to do is to really start talking about, okay, well, what's actually going on? And this is a photo at the time, and you can see how much water is coming out of the spillway here at the North Fork Reservoir. It's just boiling out of there. And as you start coming down then, well, what's happening? Well, this is a photo, you know, in front of Warren Wilson College. You know, the road was completely impassable. That farm field there had basically turned into a very broad river. And as you keep coming down, you know, this is driving across the bridge over the Blue Ridge Parkway and looking at how much the river was out of its banks. And I think, you know, this is one of those historic pictures that we're all kind of used to. That is, you come down to the U-Haul next to the current day Walmart, that, you know, the water was high enough that it was basically covering those U-Haul trucks. And unfortunately, as you start getting that much water, things start to float. And one of the things that started to float was the whole series of petroleum tanks that were, you know, through there. And so when you start looking at 100 gallons of petroleum, well, how did that happen? Well, there's a lot of petroleum tanks, and guess what? There's one, and what it did run up against is that's the bridge leading from Lowe's over into that area where Bonefish is right now. You can see that what is usually a very quiet river turns into a raging torrent that we really have to be continually communicating with our people about, you know, about what the danger is of this rising water and where we live, where we work. As we get a little bit further down the Swannanoa, this is a traffic light sitting right there. You know, there are people canoeing right underneath a traffic light that is usually up above the height of semi-trailer trucks. And so, you know, water is coming up quite high sitting in through here. And again, you know, one of the classic shots right in the middle of Biltmore Village and the entrance to Biltmore Estate. So when you start looking at it, you know, we think about those sort of shots, but the other shots that, you know, really start looking at, you know, what's going on is the huge amount of, you know, landslides that were occurring, the water line breakage, the total number of bridges that were lost up in Haywood County, Canton community, and the relocation of the music industry to a cornfield in Biltmore Estate. Well, we can help people continue to remember those sorts of things through animations and movies. And so this is the work of a UNC Asheville student that worked at NEMAC. This is actually putting Biltmore Village into a gaming engine, and the height of the water coming up onto all the buildings and all sitting through there, and a variety of different technologies that allow people to actually interact and truly understand what's going on and for people to have discussions with that as well too. I did want to pull one slide from Rick's talk and say, you know, it is very important to be looking at this linkage from floods and landslides as well too. This is really the hidden danger or the hidden link that a lot of our citizens really don't understand. And Rick Wooten's going to be talking to us about this as well too. But you really have to think about these very heavy rainfall events and the linkage between those rainfall events and when these landslides let loose. We found that out here locally in Asheville last July. You know, that was a pretty large landslide event. Cost the city $2 million in repairs just within city limits, and that's not talking about the larger expenses in Buncombe County outside the city. Well, the other big message is, guess what? The situation is not going to be getting better. If you look at the climate models, you can already see that the percentage change in very heavy precipitation over the past 30 years, you know, we've seen a 26% increase during this time, the climate models, and this is from the National Climate Assessment, you know, are just showing us that we can expect even more of these things to be happening in the future. So, you know, if you start looking at this sort of instance happening about every 20 or 25 years in our community, you might expect it to happen even more frequently and more severe. It is one of the main messages in the National Climate Assessment that climate change impacts, it's just not about warming, but more extremes. And one of the major findings of the National Climate Assessment is about this heavy downpour and being able to be ready for those sort of things. And so it's kind of this counterintuitive feel to, you know, our climate here is our continuing reality in the Southeast is we have to be dealing with drought. That's our long-term reality. Remember that average precipitation that we have here in Buncombe County is less than 40 inches. And so the city has to manage the North Fork Reservoir to handle that primary need of providing that fresh drinking water to our community. But then they also have to manage the North Fork Reservoir to be providing that second tandem, and that's flood control. And so when you start looking at this whole concept of water managers and the expertise it takes, is you can't just be saying, I'm managing the water system just to make sure that the water is flowing out of the tap. Also have to manage the water system to be handling this emergency management side of it as well too. So we've worked with the community, you know, with their values, and you start looking at the idea of flood mitigation. And as the Flood Damage Reduction Task Force started working with the community and Brown and Caldwell, we started looking at, well, what sort of things can we put into place to keep this from happening again? And we're going to be hearing from Brown and Caldwell and McCray with the city about this. But when you look at topics of what can we do to mitigate floods, you also have to balance that with ideas of economic feasibility, low environmental impact, and the ability to implement in our county. And so I think Brown and Caldwell, we came up with, what, 43 different flood mitigation possibilities. But working with the community, we could then start saying, well, which of those are going to raise to the top? And I have to give a shout out to the U.S. Forest Service. This is a decision analysis technique that they've pioneered that we're able, working in partnership with them, to bring to our local community. And being able to work with all these different drivers and work with the community and public engagement to say, okay, well, which one of these are we going to do first? And you can see these projects, Lake Craig, Beechtree Reservoir, Biltmore Avenue Bridge, that you've seen in the news and actually have been implemented as we've been going ahead. We've also done the buyouts and flood proofing. We're going to hear a little bit more about that. And we've got new building ordinances and policies, right? So we don't want to be looking at, okay, well, let's just completely vacate areas like Biltmore Village. That doesn't work for our local economy, right? But as we're looking to put new buildings in, what are ways that we can make those buildings less vulnerable? How can we give them more adaptive capacity? And so you can see these buildings are raised high. We've got parking garages underneath them that even if the water comes up, these buildings are much less vulnerable to the impacts of floods. Final message, all of us working in the room together, we have built resilience in our community. You know, I think we can really celebrate that together in the room. But as we celebrate, we also have to understand that we have to keep working together because this job's not going to get any easier. We have to keep making progress. And so with that, I am going to turn it over to the next speaker. Thank you very much.